So we're just about to have a panel discussion about Bollywood, and after that, at 6:30, we're going to have a performance. So please stay with us, we've got more to come. And I'm delighted to first introduce you to Gauri, who works very closely with us in the curation of Alchemy, who's going to host this panel talk for you. So please stay around, be willing to ask questions later, and I hope you enjoy the discussion. Thank you very much.
To the entire Alchemy team, the technical team, Rachel Harris, Jude Kelly, and the wider bunch of promoters and supporters and partners. Welcome one and all this afternoon, this evening rather, at the cusp of our new RFH performance, which is going to happen again at 7:15 today. But we just thought it'd be really nice to bring in a panel. We had a fabulous workshop led by Shiamak company, based out of London and doing fantastic work all across the United Kingdom. And before that, Rekha did this wonderful singing workshop. How about just picking up threads and sort of demystifying what Bollywood is? Talking in terms of the politics of Bollywood, talking in terms of the choreography, how do we translate dance, which really truly is a vitamin called the Bollywood vitamin. So just let's build up together. We have a fabulous panel, three of them today, and we will also open the house for a discussion, any questions coming across. Please keep it going, and we'll keep it quite informal, quite like how we would be watching a Bollywood film in our drawing rooms, not formalizing it. So let me please welcome Rekha. Rekha is a fabulous singer based out of UK again, trained in India. We'll take her journey forward through. Shruti's leading the Shamanava company here with her partner, and been here for the last 6 years now, and been with the company for the last 18 years, trained in India. We have Samir Bamra. Samir is a director, presently touring a fabulous company work all over the country, hoping to take it to India as well at some point. Perhaps. Fingers crossed. Passionate about Bollywood and the directorial element that comes in. We'll also talk a little bit about how choreography is on screen, how do we articulate that, and how do we really understand the vocabulary of dance on cinema. So I'm going to, without delaying it more, I'm going to hand it over to Samir. And Samir is a curator, say, demystify Bollywood and take us into a different realm to understand what is Bollywood.
I'll give it my best shot. So my name is Samir Bamra, as Gauri said. I am a theatre director, writer, costume designer and producer. And all the work that I make that's live on stage is 100% full dub influenced by Bollywood. And the reason for that is when my mum was pregnant, she went to watch a movie at the drive-in cinema in Kenya. And it was a Bollywood film, and her water broke at the cinema. And the funny joke at home is that they all keep saying, because my love of Bollywood comes from the fact that I wanted to watch the movie. I personally think that they named me after the hero of that film, and you know, this hero's never made another movie after. But I personally feel that it was because the film was so bad that I wanted to just get out of the cinema. So currently I'm touring with Bring On the Bollywood, and it's my 14th production. My love for Bollywood dance itself came from none other than watching Rekha perform in Mukadita Skandar. And there she was playing the lovely courtesan Zorabai. And what would happen is that we'd go watch these movies as a five-year-old, I'd come home, and then tell my aunts what, you know, the storyline of the film, and then make me do the dance routine for them in our little veranda. And that's really how my love of Bollywood dance began. But my formal training in dance actually kick-started at 13 or 14 when I moved to the UK. And that's when I learned the art of, you know, doing the Charleston, to learning ballet, right up to the point where I decided, you know what, this is what I wanted to do full-time as a career. And it's really important that when we talk about Bollywood, we have to really talk about what exactly does Bollywood dance mean. Because the cinema itself has evolved significantly over the years. I mean, every era has cinema of its own. You look at the 1930s and Ashok Kumar, Devikarani, their dance was literally sitting on a tree, ek chiriya banke, and you know, it's all expression there. Whereas then you move to like 1950s and Bhagwan Dada actually introduced the latka chatkas that we associate with core Bollywood movement vocabulary. By movement vocabulary means the actual dance moves. And that's how it's been transformed. Dance has always been female-led in Indian cinema. And each era had its own female heroine that created a dance style of her own. And it wasn't really until you get to Helen in the late 1950s, and Helen and Shami Kapoor really together started the trend of westernizing the dance forms. Shami Kapoor adopted rock and roll, Elvis Presley, and created his own Shami style. And Helen, with her Burmese roots, learning classical Indian dance, and basically transformed the item girl that we know today, and what would be your popular music videos that you'd see on MTV. Helen was doing them back in the 1950s. And you'd see dance-offs between, cinema was very much where you'd see dance-offs between the gentle mother, the classical dancer of her time, versus Helen, who would be doing a cabaret. And that's been transforming every decade. And right now, we're at this amazing place where we're still looking at the West, but what we're doing is we're transforming. So you now see a Bernardi routine being performed to a Western song. And I guess what essentially I'm trying to say is that for me, Bollywood is world dance. We steal movement from every dance form there is. And what we add to it is expression. The heartbeat. The first sound that you hear as a baby is your heartbeat. That drumbeat is the pulse of Bollywood dance for me. And that is what makes it expressive, because it comes from here. And when it comes from here, your face lights up and you emote. And when you do that dance move, you become alive. And I guess that's, for me, is Bollywood dance, and what is Bollywood dance for me in my productions. That's what I always try to instill. So in Bring On The Bollywood, we have about 16 dance styles in each song. And they're all varied, and they're crazy. So there you go.
Back on a couple of your points there, I think we'll let Shruti take over now. Shruti, your experience of training with Shaimak as a dancer and now training and as a choreographer, how the transition actually happened. And I think you want to show us something before we start your... Okay, so we should actually cue the video. Thank you.
Done. in the middle of the songs and the promos coming out. And I always idolized Shaimak as a kid whenever I saw his work. And he used to do not many movies at all actually at that time. So he was into ad films and a lot of live events. And whenever that I saw of Shaimak's work at that time, that I was really, really young. And whatever work that I saw of Shaimak at that time really impressed me, being a little kid. I was very impressed by his, the troupe, the way they conducted themselves, the way the dancers looked, how fit they were, and how synchronized they were. And so as a child, I decided that at some point I want to be in Shaimak's troupe. And it all started off with then, and my idol was Madhuri Dixit. I'm sure a lot of you know Madhuri Dixit as an actress. What a lovely actress, what a lovely dancer, what a lovely performer. And when Dil To Pagal actually came out, when it actually released, it had a combination of Madhuri Dixit and Shaimak's work. And that was it for me. And eventually I got selected and Shaimak picked me for auditions. My auditions were the worst auditions ever. So my auditions were not good at all, and on the basis of our auditions, we would be selected to then be a part of the Shaimak Dawa Dance Company. And I had literally lost hope, but Shaimak himself was such a positive man. And at the auditions, I remember him saying that I don't care about how well you duct out all the steps. I care about how well you do that one little step, which will probably impress me for you to make you a part of my dance company. And that is the thing probably that just kept going. So he taught us a routine of about 8 to 10 bars. It was a whole, some Western jazz and some stuff that we'd never done before. So it was a combination of Western jazz, some modern contemporary work. And it just kept going onto my head that, okay, I can do whatever that I do, I've got to do it well, whatever that I do. And out of 8 to 10 bars, I did about just 2 bars, which is out of 80 steps, 80 counts, I did about 16 counts well. That's about it. And to my surprise,
funk.
Yeah, sorry.
What is funk?
Probably, I don't know what that funk was. He saw something, I was happy, and I got selected. And then from there, I was never looking back. I've been with Shaimak since 18 years. I've been representing Shaimak at through his movies. I've been a part of Taal, Kisna, Banti Ro Babli, Dhoom 2, Rabbe Banadi Jori. And been fortunate enough to work with the best of the actors and actresses and share the stage with them. And I didn't get to perform with Madhuri Dixit for a movie, but I did get to perform with her at a live event twice. So my life was made. That's what I wanted. And it was not more of getting into the Bollywood industry or dancing as a chorus dancer that really appealed to me. It was more of after seeing Shaimak do what he did at Dil To Pagal Hai, for Dil To Pagal Hai, because that was a path breaking.
There was just a cusp of changing where the choreographies became really masked.
Yes.
And very beautiful amplifiable, not just chiseled bodies.
Yeah.
You never saw that in Bollywood. There was the choruses were immaculately precise. And that was really a changing point.
That is what brought about the change. It was a little too Western for people back in India, but I think at some point people also appreciated it. He won the national award for it and a lot of accolades and everything. And that's when it just kept going. I kept doing live events with Shaimak.
And which year was this?
This was in, the movie came out in 97. I got selected in 98. So it was just a year after. And from there, like I said, it was never looking back. Been with all Shaimak's biggest productions, movies and live events, the IFA Awards. And been here in the UK for 6 years, but I keep going back to my roots, back to India, back for my training every 6 months every year. And yes, I love it. There is, a lot of people ask me, is this what you do for a living? This is the only thing that you do, or do you probably work in the bank in the evening, in the daytime, and go to teach dance in the evening? A lot of our students and their parents ask us. So yes, this is my passion. This was my hobby. It started off as a hobby, which developed into being my passion, which has developed me into my living. This is the only reason that I live for. And fortunate enough to even find my dancing partner and my life partner at the company, so it's really helped me a lot. So yes, I'm very, very happy and very positive, and I quite, because Shiamak is such a humble, down-to-earth and a positive man himself, so to take his energies to the students, I teach here in the UK and at Midlands, so to take his energies and to pass it on and to spread, to be able to even spread the joy of dance means a lot to me, and that's what I've been able to do with time. Thank you.
I think we come back to shifting intelligence, the problem with language on the screen as opposed to doing it live as well. I think that'll be a very interesting discussion too. And also to see how choreography changes from the old cinema, old songs where they would be spanning shots. We'll come back to that. But I'd like to take the lead on to with Rekha. In the lyrical element of Bollywood and how she has been inspired. And I think some of you did the workshop, the vocal workshop this afternoon. Again, Bollywood as a vitamin in your life. So I think Bollywood for me is beauty, it's music, it's dance. Without dance, there's no music. Without music, there's no dance. Especially when it comes to Bollywood. And I think that we can see, like Samir mentioned, the evolvement and how it started off with Rekha and Raja and Pakiza. And now we have Deepika in, you know, Bajira Mastani, recreating that beautiful Kathak, that beautiful traditional element. And I think music has also evolved. So the lyrics you hear now, you can actually take them back to those golden days where, you know, you saw Rekha dancing in Oorja with the fire and the gumrus. And music for me is dance. And I think expression, like you said, you dance with expression, you sing with expression. And for example, you know, Lata Mangeshkar, Asha Bhosle, and Dilji's Gyan, Asha Bhosleji. The way that she expressed each word, that was replicated by the way that Rekha danced. And I think that's what Bollywood is for me.
Would you like to hum a song for that?
Maybe for the audience, because I think it'd be great. This is a piece, this is a film, Umrah Jaan, made by Muzaffar Ali Ji, and about a courtesan living in Faizabad. That's how she was a poetess at the cusp of the independence of India, where the revolts had started, and how that was paralleled to this beautiful art form which was retained. And this was replicated on the screen by Rekha. My name is Rekha, yes.
Came from Germany and Britain it was based on the scriptures, but the dance elements were very traditional in that. And as cinema evolved by the 1930s, inspiration was coming also from Hollywood. And the Hollywood musical was now becoming norm in Indian cinema. And that norm allowed cinema to be family friendly. Without it being family friendly, and let's be honest, we Indians, we bet guns with us. And that means that we like to do stuff at home, but we have large families. And so we like to do things with our families that's clean and, you know, lovely. So we go to the cinema, and the cinema has to be family friendly. No kissing until, actually no, they've got on either.
Two flowers in the table.
And the sunrise.
The metaphors.
And that really was cinema. And that cinema has been evolving. And those stories still, I mean, you look at Manohar Desai's films in the 70s, they're still Shakespearean. Even though they relate to the idea of post-partition India and the idea of lost and found, you know, families being broken up, the idea of patriotism, that all is within Shakespeare's plays. And that allowed stories to be relevant to the communities because they were connected to Indian sentiment. It allowed them to also be broader because cinema started, you know, when you have the film like Great Gambler, where they're in Egypt and Zain Thaman's performing an Egyptian dance routine in a harem, and then they're coming to Venice or to sing in a gondola. Cinema was becoming global, and those global influences started really early on, you know. When Mithun Chakraborty started, his film career started in the early late 70s, but in 1982, he did Disco Dancer. So disco arrived in India with him. And in essence, stars adopted dance styles. Jitendra wore a lot of white trousers. And the reason why he wore them was because he was so thin, everyone told him to wear dance and white to make his legs look bigger. But he would be replicating dance exactly what the female dancer was doing. And that shows that, you know, whilst there was no male vocabulary at that time, well, there wasn't much, the choreographers themselves were looking for new words, new phrases of how to dance to a uyama mushkili yahuwin. You know, the lyrics mean nothing. And so when you're dancing to something like that that's very popular and catchy, what kind of moves would you do to it? And that's, as a result, resulted in things like fit Bollywood, because some of the, I mean, this is me now being provocative. When I watch some Bollywood dance moves today, I think it's a key fit video. It's like a Zumba, you know? There doesn't seem to be, it seems clean lines and structures there, but the essence, the emotion that I spoke about earlier is starting to disappear. Unless it's, you know, you see a Deepika now starting to do a Dhoom Dhaan and reviving that classical element of Indian cinema, it was starting to lose. You know, the semi-classical dance styles of Indian cinema were starting to get lost until Long Champion started resurging that. The last actresses that really did a lot of classical were Madhuri and Srinidhi of their time, Meenakshi Seshadri. So vocabulary has had to change, and in cinema itself, now India is so global. You know, you can get Versace out in the malls there, so once upon a time, the only car that you see on the road was the Maruti ambassador.
But I think it's also about the politics of the, and the changing scale of the society. How dance has also changed over the period of time. So from films like Pakiza or the film Paan Khan Senya, the song, where there was a lyrical representation of each word demonstrated in the dance and not just being keep fit, sort of an element coming in. And I think that started coming more when the focus changed from the main heroine to the chorus. And for after a long time, the chorus was actually respected. Earlier, the extras, as they were called, they were not really given any importance. And I think that was quite fascinating, where that became the physicality of the song was equally important to the narrative explanation through the facial expressions, through the abhinaya, which came out. So I think that was quite an interesting shift happening through that.
You look at the Saroj Khan chorus and you compare it to the Shah chorus. They are very different, and they are very different bodies as well. You know, that change has always been happening. Change is a great thing, to be honest.
So my question to you was whether that change in the athleticism has been brought into the stage, because that's what Bollywood is read, and we go for large-scale productions to show that is Bollywood. Whether a Bollywood production can be done as a solo artist, that's just a question.
Yes, it can, and we're doing it in Bollywood at the moment. When we opened the show last year, we had 9 performances at the Belgrade Theatre, and we had one dance in there, which was literally pretty much a soloist, based on the popular song "Lag Jagale" from Walk On, 1969, and we created a waltz to it in our production, and it has every bit of that emotion that Walk On is "Lag Jagale," which literally means my last embrace. Hug me one more time because we'll never get this chance again. All the emotion that's trapped in the Hindi Urdu words, the lyrics, which are very hard to translate into English, that emotion is very much captured in our production. And even when we do a Satyam's Shivam Sundar, which is now this big ensemble number, and has been reviewed really, really well, one of the reviewers said the ambition behind our presentation of Satyam's Shivam Sundar in the piece is phenomenal. And when they say that, it's because the song itself is a holistic prayer song, but we've used it as a call to the gods to help our character resolve their personal trauma. They're in a relationship with someone and they're confused about where it's going, and they're calling to the gods to allow a pathway to happen. But what dance allows us, what words don't always do, that particular dance allows us, is to really get deep into their hearts and to their minds and show the struggle that each character is having, the male's having, as he's singing it live, and the female's having it as she's dancing it for him. And that is how I think Bollywood should be. It's very difficult to translate film into live, because what film does is you have cuts, jump cuts, and zooms, and all sorts. But then you have Madhuri in Anjan doing one song that was in just literally done in one track. One take, or Far Khan in Mehmuna. And actually that I think was choreographically a better song than Madhuri's, because there's not really a chorus, Madhuri's was a solo dance, but in Mehmuna, it was a chorus, and the leads were moving around the space, and the camera angles had to move with them. And that's really tricky, because you know, zoom can suddenly go off, but
you've lost a lot of rehearsal.
Absolutely. And that is the transition that I think is the innovation that's happening in itself.
I think this brings me to the next question, to Shruti, is whether you create, because in old cinema, as I call, there were more of the pan shots and the camera travel with the dancer through up the stairs and through the bridge and sliding down, and she's dancing and she's moving on me. Whereas now it's become much more of 5-second cut into one movement, and you're isolating the body. So you do a face, hand, then you do a hand, then there'll be movement of the leg or the hip. So you know, that's where things have changed, and I think the camera has also started choreographing and leading us as viewers into it. And I just wanted to talk to you about that. How do you see that shift, and how that deliberately has been created by the directors? Or is it something that the choreographers say, no, I want the whole song to be shot this way? So it's just about
yes, the choreographers have a lot of say when they are actually choreographing a song for a movie, simply because it's how they, it's their perspective, it's how they see, how they have visualized. So some of them might want extra close, fast and quick extra cuts, and some of them would want a plain steady shot or just one camera panning through with 100 dancers. So you know, whenever, because Shyamak is the only choreographer, of course, that I have worked with and been with. So his style of working is more of working with bodies. So he works a lot of bodies. So if opposed to, you know, each one of course has their own style of working, and with due respect to every choreographer, this is the way Shaimak would look at. So he would, if you have envisioned 20 dancers, Shaimak would make that into 100. And that is what his USP is, all 100 dancers look alike. So so he would work more with bodies, whereas it's even if it is a live event or even if it's a movie, for example, Ravne Banan Jori. So it had songs from Devanand to the whole feel of the song was of the movie of Ravne Banan Jori. The song was from Nargis and Raj Kapoor to Devanand to Rishi Kapoor and everybody. So thanks. So we showed every genre, we showed every style, and Shaimak wanted that many dancers for every shot, come what may. He said, this is how I'm going to work, I need that many dancers. So he did not believe in too many cuts, but he did want the numbers and the bodies and the props. So that is how he works.
Briggs, one more question before I move to break out that. There was a moment of time where, again, like Rajan Bhimala, of course Meena Kumari was not trained dancer, but a lot of classically trained dancers, coming from a classical point of view, a lot of classically trained dancers joined Bollywood. And at that time, a lot of gurus also, who needed, it was again changing time, post independence, the patronages had gone off, so a lot of the gurus like Lachu Maharaji, Gopiji later on joined as well, came into cinema, and he saw a lot of classical, true Indian rooted classical element in the choreography. And as Sameer said, now it's become more of a world dance thing. Whether that sort of a transition is good, also to the point that now we see, to make a song popularized, we see hook steps. What is Shaimak's hook step?
So Shaimak's, one of his hook step is from Le Gayi, was this move, which was quite popular. It was a very repetitive move, and that is what the hook step is about. And one from Dhoom, which was just up and pelvis. That is what, the hip move. So that is one of his hook steps that Shaimak followed up, which became quite famous.
So I think that becomes quite an integral part in popularizing a particular song.
And these hands as well he did, so which was like dear hands in the hands.
Okay.
So this he did a lot in Le Gayi. There was this particular music which just had that guitar bass. So he used this move, this particular move a lot in the song, which gave like a little Indian flavor, but all dressed up in a very westernized
The same is the case with music as well in cinema. One song becomes popular, and it's always that tug that people want to go and see the choreography. What has been your memorable memory from childhood, which has been your sort of source of inspiration to start singing? Singing for me just started when I used to sing bhajans as a child with my mom, English nursery rhymes, things like that. But I think just coming back to the point where you're talking about how the camera angles have changed and the chorus and the solo artist, I mean, I also think it depends on how good the actor is at dancing. You have a Hrithik Roshan who doesn't need anything. He just needs, loads of cameras on him. Absolutely. And then you have a Ranbir Kapoor who has to do, 10 steps in like 20 frames because it takes so long. So I think that is also important. When you have a Salman Khan in Dabang who uses bells to make a little move, I think that's what the change is. Now Shah Rukh Khan has to do this, and that's, oh my god, that's the most amazing,
iconic representation.
Absolutely. So I think it has evolved because, even in, like you said, from classical to now the more modernized forms of art, but I think, if someone can't even make his belt dance, then, it must be great camera work on that. Rigo, what is your memory from Bachpan?
Singing-wise,
which Bollywood film? Because, we would wake up in the morning, at least I remember from my grandmother's house every summer when we went to Lucknow, we had the radio running. So morning we would have the bhajans, which is traditional thing, you'll have the bhajans playing, and then it's gradually moved to the Bollywood songs. And some of the old songs, you remember the tunes, you remember, because it has those emotional memories that you're attached with. So which is,
quite cheesy for me, because I'm in a late 80s to 90s child. The first song was the gayi, which I sang with mom every day. And a few bhajans, but if you go back to, you know, the old, you know, what's that song with Akshay Kumar about Gore Gore Mukhre, Kala Kala Chashma, Basinder songs, you know, that sort of era, that's me. And then of course, Madhuri Dixit, you know, Ek Do Teen, I actually did a bit of that in my same workshop today, actually.
And I literally found out that some of my actors in Bring On The Volume learned how to count in Hindi because of Ek Do Teen.
That's what I was thinking, language becomes, yeah. But I mean, Madhuri, like, she is, for me, the all-time grace of Bollywood dancing, incorporating the classic from the Devdas to Dilta Bhagala, the more contemporary, so a lot of memories, really. I think it also brings back that it's great to have classical base as well, because I think it allows the versatility of an actor to come out, classical language and vocabulary allows you to breathe in different ways and creates a template for the body that you can embrace also the Western moves coming in. So that becomes, I think, quite important. So for you, what was the time in Kenya? And how, I just mentioned briefly, but was that a time when the cars would drive up, you know, the drive-in cinemas were quite very popular. They used to be driving, I think they should really revive it back. They should really revive it back. Because I think just allow the entire community to drive up and watch a film and have your child, etc. So
I think like Alchemy next year should do a drive-in cinema.
It's a great idea. Here we go, Louisa. We should actually have a big screen Bollywood chart party. Yeah.
I think my, you know, I'm now quite old, so my memories of Kenya are very small and very limited. But before I come into that, I think the one thing that Rekha is not actually saying is that, back in the early 1900s when cinema started, a lot of the singers who were actors were also the dancers at that time. And that changed when playback singers stuff came into being. And only now we're seeing some of the actors who dance coming back and singing. And Priyanka Chopra.
Singing.
You're trying.
We're not talking about the technology.
but they're making attempts. I mean, even Madhuri with the Deva, she did a little
bit of
so they're making attempts to try and sing and try to revive them so that they can be seen as a whole heart, a full body performer. And that style is, I mean, we bring on Bollywood, we do that, we singing it and actually fine. But Kenya, memories. So definitely, Ukala has one of the first thing that comes to my mind. Hema Malini in the sea, made in the sea days. Helen or Nina Rumpel, you know, from East Humanism, I think. Or something like that. Helen in the mood. What was that song? She was wearing this amazing, like, amazing costume. Helen wore amazing costume. No, not Mehbooba, it was this other one. And it's actually a little bit racist, the song. It's about skin color. And you know, but within that routine, she's performing exceptionally well. And it's those memories that, you know, I'm a child of the 70s, so the retro 70s all the way. Those memories really sort of resonated in how I make work.
Just, you know, you were talking about provocative Jolie Kipichik, I just remember that's like my childhood soul. And the interpretations of that song, why it was beautiful to watch, you know, it's taken in so many different ways. So let me know, audience, how are we doing? I'm going to open the floor for questions. So keep those burning questions alive. Questions about Bollywood and the choreography, but I just want to bring one or two points which I wanted to ask. Whether choreography has can dance be a mode of social activism? A mode of social activism on the screen, because we've always portrayed women as a sexual piece of entertainment. We don't talk about androgyny in dance in the cinema. We are very specific about it. This is, I think, a little edgy, but we need to address it. We need to talk about it so we understand where we view the thing and whether dance can become a mode of social activism. We are getting into the cinema, which is talking about the corner shops. We are getting out of the open fields. We're not just talking about romance. So whether dance and whether we have matured to that level of using it as different.
different way of seeing cinema?
I think it depends on the music, firstly, and the lyrics, because obviously Indian dance is partly based entirely either on the music, unless it's a dance, or on the lyrics. Now, in terms of social revolution, Ranbir Kapoor's Sada Hat from Rockstar, to me, is a song about revolution, because he's literally, the lyrics itself are saying, give me my rights. But then you have a Meenakshi in Dhani doing a dance, and that in itself, for me, is sort of that, in a way, because she's fighting again for her rights, female, for women's rights. What we don't actually discuss is the rights of disabled performers, really, in cinema. Bollywood has a terrible record when it comes to disability. They don't have characters that are disabled, and if they are, they're caricatures. Aside from Sanjay Dutt in Sargent, who walks around, he's a hero with a walking stick. That's a disability. But one of the biggest icons for me is Sudha Chandran. She is a classical Indian dancer, became a Bollywood actor, and currently performs in some of the TV serials.
Nagin
on Colors TV. She's amazing in that.
She has a gerbil foot, so this was quite, you know, we met in the 80s.
Way back.
She went to Bharatnatyam, and she had one leg which was, she had an artificial leg on, and she became an actor
subsequently. And then her film, Not Being a Notch, I still remember the struggle that they presented in that film. It wasn't a brilliant film, but the struggle that as a character she had, I think that really resonated with me. And years later, I worked with a lovely girl in the UK called Nehal Bagaita, who is hard of hearing. And the way Nehal dances is she uses the vibrations from the music. The speakers are positioned in such a way that create vibrations in the floor. And she does that, she does it through memory, counting the moves, but also the actual, she hears the sound through vibrations. And that's such a skill. I mean, it's really hard work working with her, but she's such a talented performer that when she performs, she gives it her all. And it's really such a joy to watch her perform. I mean, I've judged her in a dance competition, and she ended up winning, and then collaborated with her quite a few times. So, personally, I think that Bollywood could do a lot more about disability, and it doesn't. So, yeah.
And I think, I'm sorry, just the one person I think that does address disability in a beautiful way is Sanjay Leela Bhansali.
Yeah.
If you look at Black, that was going to Guzarish, Black, even Khamoshi to an extent, deaf and dumb parents, and I was actually watching it the other day, it's one of my favorite movies, and the way that, you know, that they make music come alive because the parents can't hear. So I think he's one of the few directors who actually does address.
And I think Sabi's point is very relevant as well. Disabled actors also on foreground, forefront. One last triggering point, whether how modern is our dance and how relevant it is. For example, Sheila Ki Jawani. It's great to perform on screen, and we've had a lot of instances where choreographies have gone into the hinterland, the middle scale of India, and there has been a lot of difficulties for women to go and perform. So it's again bringing along the whole element of sexuality, how that's portrayed on screen, and how it can actually be performed live. And that's, whether it's a taboo, in certain parts of the country it's a taboo, we can't be flaunting and wearing skimpy dresses and performing. So it's just about that element of the reality to what is relevant in our modern society. So just anybody who wants to take this on.
What actually really upsets me is when I judge dance competitions, and I get really offended by this, is when a young person, a junior performer, is performing to a song that is overtly sexualized. I find that really offensive, and I completely berate that any choreographer or parent who allows their child to be presented in that way. That really offends me. In terms of how it's perceived in India, I think we have such a struggle in terms of educating the country and the Prime Minister in his attempts to try to modernize it through technology, certainly making attempts to do that, and recently the death penalty associated with assault on women is an indication of that. But that message doesn't always get through. Cinema has to play a part in that. I mean, we don't make government films like Doordarshan used to have an agenda to make social films. They don't anymore. So cinema, I suppose, it has to try to do that. But there are very few performers, very few actors who take it onto their shoulders to try to make a film about, you know, about social issues.
Yeah. But there's a great film, Alchemy from Ara. So if you get a chance to see it, it's about a little community of dancers who basically earn their livelihood by going and performing at marriage ceremonies and events at in the second and third tier towns of Eastern UP and Bihar, and how she's ostracized, and you know, there are a lot of elements which come with short hair. So there were a lot of these subtexts running with that, but I think cinema is addressing that, and I think dance is the best medium. We all are blessed to be able to be as dancers and musicians and artists, to be able to explore that forum of cinema together. May I request any questions from the house? Surely. Gentlemen, please introduce your name and your romance with Bollywood, and then the question. We need to know that.
Yes. Yeah. My name is Mayim. I guess I'm an 80s baby, so I've grown up with a lot of, you know, the Bollywood movies that you've mentioned. A lot of the discussion's been about, you know, Bollywood in the past, and I'm quite interested to know from the panel what's driving Bollywood now, what are the modern film influences and factors, where is it seeing that sort of influence from?
So what is driving Bollywood now? Who would like to take what is driving Bollywood now? What are the influences and what is the stimulation to take it forward? Stimulus.
I am Mayam, right? Hello, Mayam. Bollywood, from then to now, like what Sameer said, I would quite agree with him. There is a lot of semi-classical and classical elements which is missing now. What is driving Bollywood now is a lot of bringbacks and remixes. If you see right from the 80s and 90s, the lovely songs, they've all been brought back. I think I'm sure you'd agree as well. And you know, the songs that I grew up dancing to or humming to, it's only that out there. And as a dancer, still I dance as well. So as a dancer, as a performer, as one of you know, sub choreographers, I quite enjoy bringing back the old songs, which is remixed now, in a way, in a little modern, yet keeping its originality, you know, intact as well. So I quite enjoy that, and I think the musicians, to the choreographers, to the directors, like the bringbacks and the remixes, and that's the reason why that is something which is being continued upon. And this is my personal opinion.
May I just add, is it because the old lyrics did have a lot of meaning, and whether now lyrics have really changed the value and it's become more of a you know, chakta attitude.
No, though there are songs, yeah, though there are songs like Tamma Tamma and Tuchi Padiya Mas Mas, which you know, is not very meaningful lyrics, but yet fun, not intensive at all, yet fun and catchy. So songs like that are doing a good comeback, and at the same time, right from the dawn songs like Ye Mera Dil, Helen, you know, that is a definite comeback and bring-back. So in songs like that, people enjoy. Even in fact, one of the beautiful, I think it's a ghazal, which is from, which is now brought back in Edil Mushkil, Ajani Ki Zidna Karo.
Ajani Ki Zidna Karo.
So it's brought back in a very beautiful manner because of the song, the lyrics of the song, the style of the song. It's brought back in a nice contemporary, yet a jazzy
rhythm. I agree with what you're saying, but a lot of my musician friends and artists, they can't understand what is happening to music. I mean, I'm quite, you know, I love dancing to Tamma Tamma and things like that. The new Hamma Amma song, you know, okay, Jami, yeah, my mom's passing. But I think in terms of what Bollywood is now, I think it's what people like to enjoy. It's going by the masses. You know, it's can this be played in a club? Can people jive to it? People have a great time. And when I make original music, that's the first thing that I think about. Or can this play in a club? Can it be remixed? And I think it's a conditioning that if I want success,
You have to just maybe step out of the box and think, okay, think commercial, and then later on, when you have an ayat from Bajira Mastani by Harich, and you have a Deewani Mastani. Such stunning compositions, original music, but I think in terms of where it is now, it is about the mass. It's about, will this play in the club? Will people buy it? You know?
Will it be popular?
But it's also about the filmmaker themselves, because you expect amazing music to come from a current genre film or something, but the Saudi film. I'm really looking forward to Padmavati and what he will do in terms of choreography with them. Sanjay is a director, so he has a very strong choreographic eye. And so I think that, yes, there will be more collaborations with abroad and more on foreign styles influencing, as it's always been. I've literally been doing some research not so long ago, and I met with a lot of court musicians while I was in India over 7th of January. And I met an 80-year-old man on the harmonium, and he played jazz tunes on it. And this is an 80-year-old court musician who used to go with the courtesans to perform mehfils in the villages. And there he's playing me, and I was just literally astounded with what the harmonium could do, because my understanding of the harmonium was that it only does this kind of music, you know? And then this sound was so rich and important. I'd like to see more of that.
Thank you. Anyone else? This is a young gentleman I just met from Shaimak's company. He's training with Shruti at the moment.
Yeah, you've got a nice student.
How many people were there for the... Yes, ma'am?
What I'd like to bring in is talking about dance coming from the Ramayana. And again, as Shakespeare, we seem to forget our gypsy population. They go back a long, long way. And I mean, we could go and see the Mango and the Indian dance. That's how it is, so like mirrored images. So that's one part that says you're a nostalgia.
Perhaps more folk styles that if you look at Bollywood and flamenco, there are some parallels, and that's an element that we haven't covered in the conversation so far.
I mean, I would personally say you're better qualified to answer that question, because the link between Kappa and flamenco is incredible.
Yeah.
Spain and the Roman gypsies, that relationship is over 800 years.
Yeah, I think a lot of the influences are there, and you're talking about folk.
No, we were talking about Indian dance.
We're talking about gypsies.
Indian dance, and you know, that comes from the desert areas. And the Egyptian population in that areas, and that has come into the Indian dance movements. So not only Ramayana,
but yeah, so there has been influences of that as well, the gypsies, as we call it, all the folk elements coming in. But I think that's also quite relevant to the type of cinema being made and where the story rests, where the situation is, where we need to have a Helen dancing around the fire and having the gypsy element, or to that effect in Bajirao Mastani, where Kathak becomes the main spine of the choreography.
According to the element of gypsies in your film, so you have films like Parampara, or much earlier, the one that I can remember, what Jitendra, and then the Hindi.
You seem to be obsessed by Jitendra.
My hero, jumping jack, so those kind of films reflected a particular kind of community. I don't always think they did justice to that community. And they presented that out to be money grabbers that had sometimes no values, which I think is completely wrong, because their belief and their motto is they'll die for a friendship. And that, I think, is something that we should be looking at, we said.
I think it's some very interesting pointers which are coming. I wish we could put them together and propose it from the Alchemy side. But great discussion, guys. I think Bollywood is I totally call it the vitamin Bollywood.
where it really transcends and takes you to the whole romance of where you start looking at life. The music is a tug. The hook steps are actually the true juice of what dance is. So I take this opportunity on behalf of Alchemy and the entire team to thank Rekha, the 19-year here. So let's give them a big hand. Thank you, Rekha. To the wonderful journey of discovering music. Shruti, thank you. Embracing the ramifications of Summit Dance Company. And Sameer, thank you, the White House. All the best for the tour and appreciate it.
Thank you very much, Gloria. And thank you for being here for the panel discussion. And we've got one more special treat for you. We've got a performance of Shiamak dance who will be moving on to the Clore Ballroom next. So I'm going to ask you if you can help us to, by clearing the floor, give us a chance.